correspondent for The Independent. He's also author of The Jihadi's Return, A History of the Rise of ISIS. Thanks very much for being with us. What do you make of this material? Here's this German author who says he negotiated for 7 months access to ISIS. We don't usually see ISIS with Western journalists in casual conversation. What did you make of this?
I thought it was pretty valuable stuff. Certainly what he was told and what he discovered was very much along the same lines as what I was told when I was outside Mosul on Kurdish territory a few weeks ago. I think he gives the impression of a powerful movement, mm-hmm. which is not imploding under the weight of Western airstrikes. So I think it was pretty interesting and well worth him doing it. Obviously, extremely dangerous.
Well, why do you think ISIS is doing the, obviously extremely dangerous, some would say reckless and slightly insane, but he says he negotiated for all these months. Usually we see ISIS in a very different context with Western journalists. Why do you think they chose to allow this man to visit them for 10 days and then allowed him to leave? Is there a shift going on?
It seems to be their shift. They must be conscious that it does them no good to completely seal themselves off from foreign journalists. And people can say whatever they want about ISIS when there's a vacuum of information. So it's going to be to their discredit. I mean, it's a pretty appalling organization. So mm-hmm. I'm not sure that they're going to increase their popularity. Anywhere. But they are an organization that's always been very conscious of their public image. I mean, think of the amount of energy they put into making videos to go on YouTube, the social media. So it's not too surprising in some ways that they want to maybe have some foreign journalists there as well. Though I doubt if there'll be a great flood.
Right. Well, Patrick, what I found interesting is that this author, this journalist who traveled to Mosul, essentially said that the city that it didn't look this. We're used to seeing these Raqqa Square beheading pictures and absolutely awful images coming to us from this ISIS-controlled territory, but that it didn't look that way when he was there. However, that the organization is actually probably more dangerous than people think it is, which I thought was interesting because they have a really firm grip on a giant city like Mosul.
Yes, I think that I think it's a good point to make, and I think it's true. I mean, it's rather surprising after a year in which the Islamic State has taken an area in Iraq and Syria, which is the same size as Great Britain, that people still underestimate them. But I think that this is probably true. And certainly what I was hearing from people who just come from Mosul was mm-hmm. very much the same, that they had imposed a sort of brutal order there, that they did control prices in the markets and make sure the bakeries were operating, but that life was still pretty tough with no mains electricity mm-hmm. or fresh water from the taps and so forth. But they clearly do have a grip on Mosul. And I think they have a grip on all the other areas that they've conquered.
And these individuals he's speaking to all speak fluent English in many cases, which is interesting as well, highlighting the notion that many foreign fighters are traveling into Iraq and Syria to join this group. And one of the things that he said confirmed what many military analysts and experts have said, is that you can't defeat ISIS with airstrikes. One of the reasons being in this particular case that ISIS is spread so thinly inside of Mosul, you'd have to flatten the entire city if you want to get rid of the few thousand fighters who control it. And this is going to be probably the biggest challenge for any military force that wants to rid itself of ISIS. So it can't be the answer.
Yeah, I think that, in 2006 to 2007, I mean, the U.S. had 150,000 troops in Iraq. They had air support overhead. And, you know, it wasn't a solution to the problem, and it isn't going to be now. I mean, there are certain things they can't do anymore, which is go straight down the road in convoys of a couple of hundred trucks packed full of their fighters. They've distributed their heavy weapons and tanks, and they've moved out of headquarters buildings. But after that, it's obvious that it's difficult to find targets to hit.
All right, Patrick Cockburn, thanks very much for joining us, Middle East correspondent for The Independent. Thanks for your time this evening with more on this story. More now in our breaking news.